Hi. Android has officially supported Kotlin since 2017, and there are good reasons why we fell in love with Kotlin. First of all, the language takes care of a lot of boilerplate, allowing the developer to spend more time focusing on the business at hand. Next, Kotlin's strong type system helps prevent runtime issues like null pointer exceptions and string format issues. In fact, we did the numbers on the top 1K apps, and we found that amongst the top 1,000 apps on Google Play, those that use Kotlin have 20% fewer crashes per user than those that don't. Android developers have been writing their apps using the Java programming language for many years, and there's a wealth of existing libraries written in Java. It would be hard to get started with Kotlin without the seamless interop with the Java programming language, allowing for gradual adoption of Kotlin into existing projects. And if you're still not convinced why Kotlin is a great fit on Android, later in this talk I will show you how coroutines and structured concurrency solve one of the most difficult problems developers face when writing Android apps, running asynchronous operations in a unique way. A recent survey shows that developers who adopt Kotlin are on average 50% more likely to be very satisfied with their programming language. The same survey shows that 60% of Android Pro developers are using Kotlin in their codebase. And more than 70% of top 1,000 apps in Google Play Store now contain Kotlin code. The credit for creating and maintaining Kotlin, of course, goes to JetBrains and its wonderful teams of engineers. Since officially supporting Kotlin 3 years ago, Google has stepped up to help this awesome project. Together with JetBrains, we formed a foundation for Kotlin to ensure that the language ages well. For example, through a careful process of vetting breaking changes. But our contributions extend beyond policies and reviews. Google has a team of engineers contributing to the Kotlin compiler as their full-time job, currently focused on helping get the new IR backend and frontend compilers ready. We're also working on building Kotlin-related tooling, such as Kotlin symbol processing, about which you'll learn a little bit more later in this talk. We've also been improving the way we teach Kotlin on Android. We've created or updated documentation, ensuring that the samples are in Kotlin as well, created collabs to help you learn Kotlin, and articles and videos targeting all levels of developer experience and familiarity with Kotlin. Finally, we've been working closely with JetBrains to bring Kotlin to universities by creating a university curriculum and training professors to teach Kotlin in faculties in India. Here's an overview of some of the ways we've expanded the Kotlin support in Android in the last year. On the library side, we've added new Kotlin-first libraries, such as Paging 3 and Jetpack Compose. We've also added new Kotlin extensions for Play Core and Google Maps. These make using the existing APIs more Kotlin idiomatic. As Android developers, you spend a lot of time interacting with the Android SDK. And that's why on Android 11, we've added more nullness annotations, making your calls to those APIs safer. Developers' productivity comes from great tooling. As such, we've added built-in Android Kotlin Live templates, which allow you to use shorthand to add common Android constructs to your Kotlin app. At the same time, new Kotlin-specific lint checks help you make Kotlin code more language idiomatic. And actually, this is specifically useful if you're transitioning from the Java programming language to Kotlin. Looking at the compiler toolchain, R8, our shrinker tool, contains new Kotlin-specific optimizations. For example, eliminating Kotlin intrinsic checks when it can prove the whole application doesn't need them, and Kotlin metadata rewriting that allows the compiler to recognize, for example, extension functions and suspend functions, which don't exist natively in the JVM. Materials to help you learn Kotlin are also expanding. For example, Kotlin Vocabulary is a YouTube series that explains a different Kotlin keyword in each video. Make sure to check it out. Looking at documentation, we've updated our Kotlin page on developers.android.com. And there's one update that I want to highlight here, the new case studies page, where you can read about the benefits that different apps saw when adopting Kotlin. Finally, Kotlin Everywhere, the program we ran together with JetBrains and other Kotlin developers around the world. and it's reached over 30,000 developers, showing the incredible enthusiasm for the language from communities globally. And speaking of last year's Google I.O., that's when we first unveiled a new project that will define the future of building UIs on Android, and it's built entirely on Kotlin. I'm talking, of course, about Jetpack Compose, our new unbundled declarative UI toolkit, made for the demands of rich, beautiful, modern apps. It reached an important milestone just a few weeks ago, and is now available for everyone to try in alpha. If you look closely at the Compose project structure, we see that Jetpack Compose using a custom Kotlin compiler plugin to transform the declarative UI functions you write into the app's UI elements. The plugin is built on compiler extensions that we build in close collaboration with JetBrains. What I like a lot about Compose is just how nicely it leverages a lot of the Kotlin idioms. Functions are the basic building blocks, relying heavily on higher-order functions, trailing lambdas, default arguments, and more. But Kotlin at Google is not about just Android and the externally facing libraries and tools that we released. Within Kotlin, we're also doubling down on Kotlin. Over 60 of our apps are now using Kotlin. And here you see a few of Google's most popular apps that have all started using Kotlin in their code base. Our large internal code base counts over 2 million lines of Kotlin code. And we've recently started using Kotlin for server-side code too. As part of us building Kotlin support for our internal code base, we've added Kotlin support to some of our core libraries, such as gRPC and protobuf. The gRPC work has recently been open source, and protobuf will follow soon. We're also using our large internal code base to help vet the new compiler work that is available in Kotlin 1.4. And speaking of Kotlin 1.4, it brings many improvements. On the compiler side, this includes language additions, type inference improvements, and generating type annotations in bytecode for Java 8+ targets. On the library side, 1.4 brings a common reflection API, PROGAR configuration for Kotlin reflection, and new contracts. The release also brings a slew of performance improvements all across the board. Kotlin 1.4 is available for Android instantly, whenever you decide to switch to it, without waiting for any OS updates. These new features help with productivity for sure. However, the biggest thing that will help your productivity is tooling performance. And we've heard you. Both JetBrains and Google are working hard in this area. The new front-end compiler, which I mentioned earlier, will deliver large improvements. But as writing a new compiler is a large undertaking, and we want to make sure that the compiler is not only fast, but also correct, it will be a while until this is available for stable release. So we need to make sure we add additional performance gains in the meantime. We've been working on supporting the Kotlin Gradle plugin to make annotation processors more incremental, as well as helping annotation processor authors make their annotation processors ready for incremental runs. To help track down IDE performance issues, the Google and JetBrains team have been organizing combined performance hackathons. These have led to numerous improvements in Kotlin 1.360 and above. On the Gradle side, we're working with Gradle Inc. to make drastic changes to its model for incremental compilation under a project named Instant Execution. Combined with additional caching for faster up-to-date checks, we're seeing up to 30% improvements in controlled experiments. This work is under heavy development, so expect more news in the coming months. If you're a library author, then performance matters even more for you, and there are several tools that can help you. First is the Explicit API mode in Kotlin 1.4. With this mode enabled, the compiler helps you be intentional about the public API you're exposing when writing a library. In this mode, you have to explicitly declare visibility modifiers and type specifications. To enable it, update your Gradle file to add the Explicit API file. Then, depending on your configuration, these Explicit APIs can produce errors for strict mode or warnings. Next is a new project from Google called Kotlin Symbol Processing. Our data shows that many Kotlin builds are significantly slowed down by annotation processors. The Kotlin toolchain needs to perform lots of magic to make this run seamlessly between Java and Kotlin, leading to performance concerns. So we have been working on Kotlin symbol processing, or KSP for short, as an alternative to this. Instead of using KAPT, developers can now build lightweight plugins that run as part of the Kotlin compilation process. KSP allows for incremental resolution of symbols and from porting some existing annotation processing, we've seen 30 to 40% faster compilations. KSP comes with a rich set of APIs and provides access to all Kotlin symbols, including ones that are not available in the Java programming language, such as properties, function types, and more. KSP is multi-platform ready, so you can write your symbol processor once and use it on all target platforms your project uses. While KSP is still in developer preview and not quite ready for production usage, we want to invite existing annotation processor authors to give it a spin and provide us with feedback with the short link visible on the slide, or via the KSP Slack channel on kotlinlang.org. All right, starting with AGP 410 beta 03, add support for Kotlin metadata rewriting. Kotlin metadata is used by the compiler when linking against libraries written in Kotlin, so that the compiler can recognize, for example, extension functions and suspend functions which don't exist natively in the JVM. Kotlin metadata is also needed for Kotlin reflection calls at runtime. So previously, R8 was unaware of the Kotlin metadata. So when shrinking a library, it would remove or destroy the metadata, making it no longer usable. With new versions, it will correctly process all Kotlin metadata information, making it useful for library authors wanting to process their libraries with R8, as well as for compiling code that uses Kotlin Reflect. All right. I'm sure you're all familiar with the async task class, right? Just in case you haven't moved to other solutions for async programming, in Android 11, we mark this class as deprecated. Okay, so what should you use instead? Well, developers have turned to various custom solutions involving threads, executors, or higher level libraries, such as RxJava or Guava. And with Kotlin, there's one more contender, and that is Coroutines. Coroutines are the Kotlin way for asynchronous programming, with full support in the language and libraries since version 1.3, released over 1.5 years ago. In one of our recent surveys, we saw that over 50% of professional developers who use coroutines are seeing increased productivity. So here you see a small example using coroutines to perform an asynchronous call to retrieve server data, followed by an asynchronous call to store the data in a local database, followed by a UI update. Coroutines code is executed in a scope. In Android, we have libraries to tie the lifetime of these calls into the Android lifecycle. Dispatchers allow you to schedule execution of network and database access on an IO background thread. Async network calls can be made through libraries like Retrofit that support coroutines out of the box. And here, we're using Vroom's coroutine support to store the data on the device without blocking the UI thread. Finally, we pass the value on the view model to be displayed in the UI. With all these asynchronous steps, the IDE clues you in on any asynchronous behavior with an icon on the left of the code. We've recently announced that coroutines are the recommended solution for async code on Android. And if you haven't adopted Kotlin yet and are struggling with asynchronous programming, this is another great reason to take another look at Kotlin. You might wonder why so many developers choose to pick coroutines as their async solution and why we stand by their choice with our official recommendation. Coroutines are a particularly good fit for mobile apps running on Android. Structured concurrency helps developers scope the work to the application lifecycle and prevent memory leaks. Next to this, callback-free code is easier to read and less error-prone, while built-in support for cancellation and natural exception handling helps ensure the error case is handled gracefully. Many of our APIs already support using coroutines. To enter the world of coroutines, we've created special made coroutine scopes that allow you to run async code inside view models. And within this scope, you can make use of the coroutine support in various Jetpack libraries. Let's look at a few examples. So, for example, in the Android Room library, you can easily access databases without blocking the main thread through coroutines. All data access statements, insert, update, delete, and query, provide a suspend version and ensure that the database is accessed on a background thread for you. And query allows you to return flow as well, not just the suspend functions. Like this, you can observe the changes in your database as they happen. Meanwhile, longer running tasks are often modeled through jobs inside Work Manager. With Coroutine Worker, you can easily model job cancellation. If the database and HTTP client provide suspending version of their APIs, we have suspending calls all the way down. Everything looks sequential and it's easy to read. The functionality for both Room and Work Manager is provided via extension functions and KTX artifacts, so extensions to existing libraries. But in some of our new libraries, we started with coroutines from the ground up. And a great example is our new Paging 3 libraries. So for example, to define a source for the list of users that you need to display on the screen, you would implement a paging source and override the load method. As load is a suspend function, you can easily call other suspend functions like a backend call. Then paging allows you to work with flow of paging data, giving you more flexibility and finer grain control of the data you end up displaying. Another example of a library built on coroutines and flow is DataStore, which is a new and improved data storage solution aimed at replacing shared preferences. So DataStore provides two different implementations. Proto-DataStore that lets you store typed objects backed by protocol buffers, and Preferences DataStore that stores key value pairs. Data is stored asynchronously using coroutines, and it can be retrieved using flow. So for example here, I'm getting a setting from the data store. And every time this setting is changed, my counter flow will emit the new value. Jetpack Compose also provides integration with coroutines. So for example, you can launch a coroutine in the scope of a composable. Like this, you get to call suspend functions in your composable. So coroutines are the recommended solution for async code on Android. But what does this recommendation mean for Java users and people who have adopted other high-level asynchronous programming libraries? So the great thing about coroutine libraries is that it makes it entirely possible to write interop support for both libraries. So for example, paging will ship with RxJava and listenable future compatible APIs. Conversely, for libraries that have not yet adopted the coroutines API, you can use many third-party adapters, such as the one that converts a task-based API from Google Play services to coroutine suspend calls. And you can even write your own. We recognize that many of you will want to begin learning about coroutines, and we made sure we've got you covered. Over the previous months, we've been updating our learning materials, including our coroutines collabs, multiple coroutine articles covering a wide range of topics from basics to deep dives into coroutine internals. And finally, you can check out our conference talks from Android Dev Summit, Kotlin Conf, as well as specially recorded coroutine intro videos. So to wrap things up, I hope it's clear to see that Android loves Kotlin. The language helps developers be more productive and makes them happier with their toolset. We continue to expand support for Kotlin within Android, and Google is expanding its own use of Kotlin, both in our Android application and on the server side. Google is working closely with JetBrains to make the language and tools even better. Kotlin 1.4 brings many enhancements, and we would love to hear your feedback on the Kotlin symbol processing. Coroutines are now our recommended way of doing asynchronous programming on Android for Kotlin developers, as it provides a structured, easy-to-read, and less error-prone way to do the many asynchronous tasks Android developers need to code all the time. For those new to Kotlin, we hope our continuously expanding documentation, code labs, and videos helps you get started easily. And with that, thanks for watching.